So our audio system, for those of you that weren't here, has crashed, and so we're gonna pass the mic tonight. And the audience, if anyone comes to speak, will have an operational mic at the lectern. Is that right? That's the one that works, so don't be deceived by these other microphones that don't work. We have already said the Pledge of Allegiance, and we have already conducted our closed session, so we are streaming live from that iPhone right over there. And we are now going to have our one proclamation, and Councilmember Cecil Buckwell is going to have our one proclamation. My agenda says Aaron Scarborough is here.
Yes. Actually, Carla Castillo.
Oh, please bring anyone you brought with you forward.
Yes, I'm going to use this too. Whereas Hispanics make up an important portion of the restaurant labor force, working as entrepreneurs, chefs, line cooks, servers, and much more, whose leadership and hard work strengthen our local economy. And whereas Hispanic restaurateurs consist of immigrants, first-generation Americans, second-generation Americans, and beyond, all of whom are pursuing the American dream. And whereas Hispanic restaurateurs, despite the many risks and personal sacrifices they encounter, continue to be inspirations to their families, employees, and the community, and their success stories we can learn to emulate. And whereas it is fitting and proper to celebrate the influence of Hispanics who continue to enrich our culture in the region and in the city, including the food we eat. Now, therefore, I ask the Mannheimer Mayor of the City of Asheville to hereby proclaim October 28th as Hispanic Restaurateur Day in the City of Asheville and encourage all citizens to recognize and celebrate this day with appropriate activities, which I would guess include eating.
Well, I just want to say thank you. I'm very honored to receive this award on behalf of all the people that are so hardworking and that provide the food that you guys make, which is amazing, and that I love to cook, and I'm very passionate about it. So I just want to say that this is very important for the Hispanic community and all the people that work really hard. And every time you go to a restaurant, you'll find them, you know, and just be aware that they're there, you know, providing the best food that you guys can eat. Thank you.
Will you please introduce yourself to us, too? So, will you please introduce yourself?
Yes. My name is Carla Castillo. Okay. Thank you very much.
On our consent agenda, we have one item setting a public hearing for, I think it's item I, a public hearing, is it item I, Maggie? Am I getting it right?
Yes.
We had a request from EJ Kapoor, who you all know, to set that public hearing for the next council meeting because he thought people might want to attend an election day. It would be hard to get people to attend. So if it's all right, we would move that hearing to December 13th rather than November 8th. Okay, because we're not having a November 22nd meeting because it's the Thanksgiving week. Yes. No, I was just asking you, I was just telling you that I was going to change the consent agenda to reflect that change so when we vote on it. Are there any items that anyone has any questions about, comments about on the consent agenda? If so, I will pass the mic to you. Item J.
So item J is the resolution authorizing city manager to implement a fair free day on November 8th, which is election day, to increase opportunities for voters on election day. So in March, when council authorized a fair free day for the primaries, we had, I thought, agreed that we would look at the effectiveness of whether a fair free day actually increased voters. There was no real way for the city to figure out how many people that were riding the bus actually voted. However, ridership was down that day on average. And also, the Multimodal Transportation Commission did not recommend a fare-free day because they didn't think it would be effective in increasing voters or reducing barriers to voting, and it cost the city lost revenues. So while I agree with the objective, I don't think a fare-free day actually works to increase voting or decrease the barriers. The one thing I would ask that I noted in the staff report is that in connection with if we do a fare-free day, we say that the city's next day paratransit service, which is available to individuals with disabilities, is also fare-free. I would propose that we just do a fare-free day for paratransit as opposed to an across-the-board fare-free day, and also propose that staff and or the Multimodal Transportation Committee study this and come up with an alternative that is more effective than a fare-free day.
Okay, so let's do this. Let's consider that item separately from the consent agenda because maybe other people want to comment on it. Is there any other item on the consent agenda that we need to consider separately or that there's a question about?
I just want to make a comment
about this. To the comment I want to make is around item P, which is a budget amendment in the amount of $40,000 from the Asheville Downtown Association for the Lexington Avenue Public Art Project. Are there any members of the Asheville Downtown Association in the audience tonight? I just wanted to say thank you so much for making the push to put this money together to make this art project happen. That kind of willingness to step up and get other people to step up makes it really easy from up here to get the wheels turning and to continue to add to the fabric of our downtown, so thank you.
Okay, any other item that someone has a question about or wants considered separately? Okay, then, do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda except for item J?
So moved.
Okay, Cecil moved.
Second.
I had a tie for second, Gordon and Julie. Okay, all those in, oh, I'm sorry. If anyone in the audience would like to comment on the motion to approve the consent agenda minus item J, this is your opportunity. Okay, no one wants to comment on the consent agenda. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, now, item J, is there anyone else who would like to, okay, here you go.
The staff report did not reflect whether the transit committee had actually approved this or discussed it. It said they were going to do that at their October retreat, which I think happened last Friday. I checked with Adam Charnak. They did vote to recommend it this time around.
Gwen, I appreciate you thinking about this really critically and making sure that we're really trying to attain the objective that we set out to attain. I guess where I would go with this is that if we were to decide to go ahead and make it fare-free today, and as a matter of policy, to think into the future that election days could be fare-free in the city of Asheville from here on out. People who lived here just knew that election days were fare-free, then we wouldn't have to be doing the promotion every single time if it became just known that voting days were fare-free days. It's my guess that that might have more of the effect that we're seeking. But that said, I'm definitely open to hearing whatever suggestions come back from the other committees. But as far as for November the 8th, I'd like to make a motion that we move ahead.
Anyone else wishing to comment on this item? We have a motion and a second. Anyone in the audience who would like to comment on this item? Yes. Please state your name and you have 3 minutes.
My name is Kim Roney and I'm a member of the Transit Committee, so thank you for bringing up that information that we did indeed endorse it. Thank you to Gordon for bringing up the idea and for Keith seconding. If every day that we voted was fare-free, then it would be easier to market. I have used the bus to get even a short period of space through the rain to get to my poll. I can't possibly have been the only one. And if you're somewhere else in the city, maybe at work, but you need to get to the pole that's closer to where you live, that's when I've also used it. Thanks.
Is there anyone else wishing to comment on this item?
Just briefly, Gordon, I think you had a wonderful idea of studying possibly in the future, making this permanent so it won't be something that comes up every election cycle. I would love to explore that, maybe have that, kind of looked at and possibly placed on the agenda if other council members would be willing to do so.
And I think the way that would come up is in the fees and charges, or maybe I've gotten wrong about that, but there is a, like all the other free days are already laid out, and so maybe that can just be part of that proposal that comes to us all at the same time. Yeah, Ken is nodding. Okay.
Okay, did anyone else? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Okay, we have two items under presentations and reports. First, we have the staff mass exodus after the consent agenda is concluded. The first item is the Haywood Street planning process. We're hearing an update from the task force. This is a two-part update. The first part will be presented by Chris Joyelle. This is the facilitator's report. And then the second part will be the advisory committee recommendations for short-term use, and Andrew Fletcher is here to do that. Before we begin, will the members of this task force that are here tonight let us know who you are when you stand up, maybe? Okay, all right, well, thank you for coming tonight.
Did we launch the PowerPoint?
I don't know how deep our technical problems extend.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us here tonight. I'm Chris Joyelle, Executive Director of the Asheville Design Center, and on behalf of the advisory team, I would like to thank you for affording us this opportunity. The city contracted with the ADC to facilitate a visioning process in April, and in May we brought a project for public spaces to town, and our aim at that time was to change the question from what do you want to see here to what would you like to do here. And that is adhering to the designer's mantra that form should follow function. And we want to try and understand how people want to use the space before there's any determination of how that space is going to, what its form will actually start to look like. In our reporting, you'll see that we've gathered public input from a variety of different sources, attempting to reach everyone from neighboring stakeholders to citizens throughout Asheville. We've received well over 1,000 comments to date, and no surprise, they cover the full spectrum of ideas, everything from a grassy park to a parking deck, and everything in between. So ADC is aiming to conduct as transparent a process as possible. And to that end, we've been capturing the comments that we've been receiving verbatim in a massive database that we're going to be sharing with the advisory team. We're also working with a Lenora Ryan graduate class called Visions for Sustainable Communities to code this input and help make it easier to digest. As an example, this is just something that Project for Public Spaces had provided us. But this is one example for how this data could be presented. The graph quantifies public input regarding specific uses and amenities on the left, and on the right you'll see a description of requested qualities that they were hearing from the public as well. The advisory team has defined their own list of about 17 different intangibles or benefits that they would like to see their vision to achieve out there. And some of those benefits appear to conflict with one another, but the team is intent on striking the right balance to meet the needs of as many Asheville-ians as possible. The advisory team's final work product will contain their recommendations for appropriate uses and amenities, and a bubble diagram that will illustrate how those elements can relate to one another within the property. This is just a programming exercise. I think it's really important to be clear about that. We don't intend to design the space. Instead, we want to be able to show how the various uses and amenities can share an acre of land, and this is a conceptual way of approaching that. So the advisory team has met monthly since June, usually in the boiler room of the Grove Arcade on the third Monday of the month. And in addition, the group has also elected to split into two subcommittees, one that addresses uses, the other that is studying the site constraints and opportunities. So with that, and this is just a shot from the basement of the Basilica where we had our latest breakout meetings, I'll turn things over to Andrew Fletcher, who will tell you about the progress of the advisory team.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. My name is Andrew Fletcher. I'm recently was named the chair and spokesperson for the Haywood Page advisory team. It's my pleasure to introduce our ideas for temporary uses of the site at this time. But first, I'd like to say thank you to the support that we've had from city staff and from the Asheville Design Center. Over the past few months, they've presented us with tons of information and resources and answered many of our questions. So now we know a lot more about the site and its possibilities. So the first section sort of our meetings has really been educational for us. The 18 members of the group that you've already seen stand up here, they're selected by council, and as Chris said, we've broken this into two subcommittees. I'm really happy to report that the pace of conversation and deliberation of the group has really accelerated and increased in the past couple months. By implementing some temporary uses of the lighter, quicker, cheaper variety in the study area, we hope that the site can become active and useful to the community in the near term, and that the successes and failures of temporary uses will be greatly informative to the end product that we bring back to you guys when our work is done. Creating and communicating the end product of our team, which is a program for the space that we can then hand back to you with the full confidence that the community has weighed in. As you can see, the Asheville Design Center has collected a tremendous amount of information input from the community, and we can't wait to start digging into that after it is finalized. So here's a word cloud of all the temporary uses that we generated from our meetings. The ideas range from the practical to the innovative and even the whimsical, as you would expect from a city like ours. And while there's no order of importance here, we want to make it clear that we're not prioritizing any one of these uses over any of the other. Our hope is that any feasible ideas generated from this list engage the most number of Asheville residents and use the site as fully as possible in the near term. We've not vetted the feasibility of these options because we've had really no guidelines for that so far, and the expertise for that does not really lie within our team. Instead, we've provided a menu of options for council and staff to explore. That means that what we're presenting to you has been created from our full imagination, which is why it's such a long and variegated list. And what we've tried to do is make sure that this menu of temporary items has come to mind from the team members and from the community. And we treat this as a menu of options for you to go forward. So obviously not all of them would be selected, but hopefully some of them would be. In keeping with that, I'd like to give you a sort of four-day example of how our ideas could look. I'd like to emphasize that this is merely an example of how this space could be activated. How this will actually work and be programmed will no doubt be different, but we as a board, we're certainly thinking about creating a rich set of experiences to be had in the space. So let's look at that. On a Thursday morning, you might have a farmer's market. This could serve the populations in the Vanderbilt, the Battery Park and Vanderbilt buildings very nicely. Perhaps in the evening, a holographic art light display, something that could be set up and taken down very simply and easily. And all day, it could be used for secure bike parking, which I think there's some city resources that are possibly underutilized for that right now. We might try allocating them there to see how they work. On a Friday afternoon, we might see food trucks, and in the evening, a school band concert that would bring in families from the community to use the space. And all day, temporary seating could be made available to make a food truck, to accentuate the food truck. On Saturday, a job fair, which would require, obviously, a partnership with another local group, but we certainly would like to see those partners come forward with ideas for the space as well. In the evening, a live performance of some type. And all day, perhaps a collection point for community compost from the residents that live nearby there. On Sunday morning, perhaps a temporary parking zone for shopping during the holiday season. In the evening, perhaps a publicly displayed movie. And all day, you could have raised garden beds that were tended by people on their days off. So this is just an example of how you could populate this site with temporary uses. And so we can see with just a few of the uses combined together, you have the potential to engage a large number of Asheville residents in many different ways. And won't that be a vast improvement? I don't even want to say these three words. We're here to overcome that stigma of this site. There are opportunities in our temporary, in our recommended temporary uses that can begin to start reincorporating this space back into the fabric of our city and of our downtown. And I believe we can do it. By using the menu of options for activating the space, going with light, quick, and cheap, we invite you to come back to us with your selections and ask you to help us to implement them, as some of us have potential partnerships already in mind. Again, we think that both the successes and failures that will come out of temporary uses of the site will be very informative to the process of coming up with the final outcome to what we will do with this property. And I know that we're not close to breaking out the silver-plated shovels, and the oversized scissors are going to stay wherever they live for a little while longer. But taking our temporary uses, we can begin to put the community back in charge of the space before we determine the permanent recommendation. So thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any of your questions that I can.
Andrew, thank you very much for the presentation. You have questions, Cecil?
Yeah, I have two questions. One is, you've been collecting comments. Is there a deadline? Are you going to set a date at which comments will no longer be collected?
For the current survey that's up now, the activity preference survey, that deadline is at the end of this month. We foresee that we'll have probably a visual preference survey that will follow once we have a chance to digest all the public input that we've received thus far to be able to inform what that looks like.
I know you've been taking comments via email as well. Is that the same date then? You're going to cut it off on the end of the month?
I know that we'll ask the group, and I think that that's going to be something for the group to feel whether or not they have adequate information to start making decisions, but I'm going to rely on the advisory team to be able to set that date for us. As of right now, I've received about 35 emails, but we are capturing those in the database and they will be coded as well.
Okay, my other question is, you provided a list from the team that's really extensive. You've narrowed it down to maybe 40 things. Probably more than that, 50, I don't know. Are you asking for council to pick and choose and to narrow it down at this time, or are you just letting us know that these are things you're discussing?
I can speak to that a little bit. We had a chance to talk about this before we went into this meeting, because that was a question I had and other council members had asked. And in terms of the process, first of all, let me commend you for all your hard work and everybody here. I know that we handed you a major task. And it's especially exciting to watch some of the younger people rise up in the leadership roles and figure all this out. So what we talked about is asking the group now to narrow this down to a recommendation for council, maybe two or three things from the temporary use list. If the committee could you know, we've seen that obviously some of these things are you know, maybe the preference of one person, or some things may be the preference of 12 people, who knows, on your task force. But if you all could take that back and bring forward to us a recommendation that we can put on under new items on our agenda for consideration. And if you can get it whittled down to two or three uses, that's a little bit more manageable for the staff to sort of evaluate them and help us vet the uses in terms of the logistics and the cost and things like that.
I understand limiting it, but considering the proposal, the notion of what could happen over 4 days, are two or three sufficient? I mean, if we're going to try, if we're going to really test things out, and we've got whatever 120 things on this list, wouldn't a dozen or more be, or something like that, be maybe a dozen? I don't know. Just to try some different things, because trying three means we're already carving it down to, you know, a dog park, a school band concert, and a Segway tour.
I have to say that I think that for the function of the group being able to come up with this a really long list was really helpful, because it got us all working together and everybody was able to feel a piece of this and some ownership. So it will be. So I think it was useful for us to generate this long list, and I think it's also useful to get this feedback from you about carving that down. And I'll leave that to you guys to decide how far, you know, what that would exactly look like, and that would help.
Thank you.
I mean, my thought on this, although that sounds like a lot of fun, that also looks like a site or a venue that has a full-time manager who's overseeing the transition between all of these different activities. And I mean, maybe that's a new part of Dana's job, I don't know. But that's just that's the thing that comes to my mind is the more that we're asked to recommend, the more management that space takes, as opposed to just saying something like, it's now open for food trucks, and the city maybe put some tables and sunshades, or, you know, I don't know. Just that's just the thing that comes to my mind, is how it gets managed.
I think that we sort of purposely didn't talk about the amount of resources that the city would require to enact these things, just because we wanted to get that direction from you, and instead of drawing our own box on that.
Well, right. So we need you to stay focused on making a recommendation, and I realize you can kind of get off on a tangent when you start talking about logistics and costs, and those are sort of unknown. And clearly for staff to try to give you sort of a pros and cons and how much the cost of 100 different uses or 70 different uses or whatever's on this list, this will be a 10-year process instead of a several-month process. So, I mean, I guess what I would say is use some common sense in terms of trying to weigh whether or not it's a realistic suggestion, but you obviously can't spend a lot of time thinking about costs and programming and things like that. The reason I would suggest whittling it down to a few things is because that gives me a better idea of what the task force really wants. If it's my concern is if it's a dozen things, then it's pretty much each person on the task force puts in their favorite thing. And that doesn't necessarily give me any indication about where there's really consensus. And we're going to be asking the staff to work up an implementation framework and cost. So it's very difficult to do that for a dozen things. You know, and so what I would say is use your best judgment. My preference would be a shorter list. Again, you know, obviously if there's some things that are sort of minor uses and could be nicely related to other uses, say for example, raised bread beds, you might easily pair that with some other use, obviously. So, but this list is very long and varied. So personally, I don't know where the rest of council stands on it, but it would be helpful to me to have a real, narrow as possible, and frankly prioritized. So that would be helpful to me.
The items sort of break down into activities and amenities, perhaps a few of each.
And I wanted to know, does the group want guidance from council at this point to help limit that list? Is that what you're looking for? Or just letting us know these are the things that are being considered?
I think that we could take some guidance on how to limit it. But as I can say, if just two or three, some of them coexist, for instance, bike parking, and other things. So I think two or three, we'd sort of be missing some opportunities that might be no-brainers by limiting it that much. But maybe a few amenities that would be there all the time, and then a few activities which would come and go would I think be helpful for us carving it down to what we can actually get bring back to.
Okay. Gary, not to put you on the spot, but do you have any thoughts about how the committee might best make a recommendation to us?
Do you need this? Oh, you need this.
Okay. Your thoughts about waiting or prioritizing this? I mean, we certainly don't want to put a lot of time and effort into something that just one person is interested in. So I think getting some kind of weighted preference, I would have imagined a process whereby all the ideas were put on the table and then you know, norm or group that. You know, which are the most common things, like with your word bubble, which is coming up more often. And so that would lead you to, well, what people are looking for is passive areas, seated areas, another thing might be looking for programmed activities. And so then it's, you know, it's, you can look at, you have them in categories, which might lend itself to that as well. And some categories, some preference of the categories, some preference of permanent improvements that would be there throughout the course. I mean, if you're going to create a parking space area, if you're going to do planning beds, from a management and operations standpoint, we don't transform Pritchard Park every day. So knowing what that you want to keep there through the course of this, that you can agree on in terms of design or layout, is one thing. The other is what kinds of activities, passive or active, you want to see. Because passive and active activities may not be compatible with each other. So that's the guidance I would give, is think about the practicality of setup and takedown, and what, whether or not you're creating a multi-purpose space, like a civic center where you things can, a convention center where you can wheel things in or out. That leaving it open so that a lot of things could wheel in and wheel out works against creating some kind of structure or setting or amenities that are built into it. So I think you have some choices. If somebody, if you're going to hand this vision document over to a professional park planner, they would ask you to say, ultimately, you know, which mix of these things do you want to have, and how much flexibility do you have in terms of the space, the physical space, and how do you want it to be passive or actively managed? Those. So what are your goals?
I'm going to pass it down, but just to kind of throw out there some things that I won't go through this list. It's pretty extensive, but things that are not as invasive or that need as much oversight would be some suggestions that I would say. As many things that you could have, you know, that don't have to have as much oversight.
Well, I think that the goal that I hear presented from your report, Chris, and from yours, is that you're looking for things to activate it now, quick, cheap, easy. So we're not looking about what's going to be the installed thing later. I wonder if it would be helpful in order, if we're to give some kind of guidance, if each of us on council would pick a dozen of these things and then collate that and find out what the top ones are. I mean, if we're being asked to give guidance, then we can hardly go one at a time and vote on these things.
Okay, I mean, we could do that, but we created this task force to make a recommendation for this. I mean, we're aware of all these potential uses, and I think it's very important that we put a nice blend of different groups represented on this task force. And I realize you guys are struggling with consensus, you're struggling with process, and I appreciate that. We did the same thing for a really long time. So it would be my preference that you all sort of take this list and you know, take a vote or however you want to determine what it is and tell us what your recommendation is. I mean, Cecil, if the recommendation doesn't mesh with what a majority of council ultimately wants to do, that would be unfortunate, because I think that the point of this is to get citizen input about the direction for this property use. So, and it's kind of our job to figure out whether we can achieve it, whether we can finance it, whether we can staff it. Those are all going to be challenges. But I really want to know what your group, what a majority of your group would like to see as a temporary use. Again, it's temporary, so I mean, we're trying some things on.
Right. You know, we've got 18 hands on the scale, and I don't think we're trying to add any more, because we already have a lot. And I do have high hopes for generating an outcome that you guys would be happy with. And if we wanted to, if you need less options, we can bring those.
Many less options.
I would say keyword is temporary, so I wouldn't spin my wheels on this too much.
Right.
Come to a consensus, but keyword is temporary.
Yeah. How about down there? You guys good? Okay. Do you feel like you have enough direction from us to go forth?
I think I have. I think I can begin to imagine what you guys are looking for. And do I understand correctly that the next council meeting is December 13th, and that is when our timetable for bringing that back to you?
That is our No. We have a November 8th. But you all are on your timetable, so if you're not, if that's too soon, you know, let us know.
We do not have a meeting scheduled before then, so I think that would be too soon.
All right. Well, that's fine. Just work with Maggie and okay. Tell her when you're ready to come back to
Thank
us.
Thank you. Do you have any more questions?
Thank you all for coming today.
Thank you.
Okay, I forgot to remind everyone to turn their cell phones off.
Except that one.
Except we got out the one cell phone on. Okay, the next presentation is going to be offered by Dawa Hitch, and I think Roderick Simmons is here too. Effective communication for projects and programs, George Washington Carver Edible Park update. This is something the council requested that the staff come and talk to us about the future of our communications with the community regarding our park maintenance, especially when it involves any time that there's a proposal for tree removal. So go ahead.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Dawa Hitch. I'm the Director of Communication and Public Engagement. Tonight, I'm going to share an overview of the strategies that we currently have in place for effective communication across the organization. And then following this overview, as Mayor Manheimer just shared, our Parks and Recreation Director, Roderick Simmons, is going to share an example of how this looks in practice. So to get us started, communication, effective engagement, and transparency are all core values of this organization, and that is seen through City Council's core values and is also reflected in the mission of our division. Managing relationships has also been identified as a focus area by the management team. So over the next year, we as a team will intentionally be focusing on improving communication across departments and will integrate standard communication approaches both internally and externally in our day-to-day operations. So how are we going to get there? It's going to take a three-prong approach. You guys have probably seen this before, but investing in a diverse communication portfolio, recognizing that we want to meet people where they are and that people choose many different ways to share and receive information. That's going to be an important key to this strategy. Second, we've got to make sure we're encouraging a culture of engagement within the organization. We know that the interactions that people have with staff are some of the most impactful opportunities we have to both share information and for people to form their opinions about what their government is doing. Third, we want to make sure we're effectively managing engagement in the community. And again, engagement involves both communication and then the relationships we're building within the community. So we've got a diverse communication portfolio. We've got traditional media, they're here tonight. We've got social media, which we are using as a backup to our normal broadcasts. And we've got our relationships. Those are three key parts of our communication portfolio, and making sure that we're communicating through all of those means we're hopefully going to meet, we're going to effectively work with the greatest number of people. We've also got to consider how our actions impact the environment around us and the people around us. So thinking about this through the circle of service is a great tool for all of our staff to employ. Right? So we want to think what it means as individuals, to our individual work units, so that we're communicating well internally, and we want to take that all the way out across to the community and think through what those impacts might be so that we're sharing information appropriately. Third tool is our spectrum of public participation. And it's really important as we're communicating with people in the community that we let them know what level of engagement we're engaging in. And it can range. It's a spectrum. It can be from just informing where we're sharing information, or it can be all the way on the other end where we're empowering people to make decisions. But being intentional about sharing where we are in that process is really important. So sometimes we may be informing, sometimes we may be asking for feedback, sometimes we may be collectively making a decision together, but we need to state that in the beginning so people understand what type of process it is. So we take all of those elements of the strategy of communication for any given project or initiative, and we pull them into a communication plan. Those plans, communication's really more, is both an art and a science, so those communication plans definitely need to adapt to whatever the project is that we're communicating. So for hiring a new HR director, that might be a quick timeline of when announcements are going to be made internally and externally. Or if it is a bond education program, you might have a 10-page communication plan that is really outlining what the messages are so everybody's clear about, you know, what our responsibilities are in communication. So those look differently, but they are a tool that allows for accountability in how we're engaging and working with the public. So in summary, we know what the best practices are. We got to think about how what we're doing is going to impact the people around us. That's internal and external. We want to consider a diverse set of tools. We want to meet people where they are. We want to do our best to reach as many different people as possible. And then we want to communicate the level of participation so that the community or the internal team, whichever it may be, understands what our goal is through this communication. And when we do that effectively, then that helps us make sure we've got timely communication, and it also helps to minimize misunderstandings. So that was a quick overview. I'm going to turn it over now to Roderick Simmons to talk about a current project that we have and how these strategies relate to that.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. I'm going to bring you an update on the George Washington College Edible Park. As you know, a few weeks ago, there were some trees removed from the park. Part of that is due to a miscommunication internally with staff. The project started before we were ready to launch it. Actions have been under investigation. We're looking at all our city policies to look at a way to streamline it and make it a process all the way through the organization so that everyone is on page when it comes to doing that. Part of the communication program that Mrs. Hitch was referring to, after the incident, I reached out to Voucher Cities, who manages the park on an agreement, and also the East End neighborhood that has some safety concerns about the lights. Looking at how do we balance that as a department when you have two competing needs for a service area. After that meeting with them, we came up with some short-term and long-term goals. The short-term goal was to look at the lighting plan and how it impacts the trees. And that's meeting within the next month. And in the long term is how do we maintain the park so that it's a safe and viable community, and what resources need to go to that and how to sustain it over a period of time. So as we continue to go through that, staff citywide is also going through a review process of not only in our department, but vegetation and tree removal. How do we handle that in the city? And that process is underway also. So hopefully we have some administrative rules on how we engage with that. One of the things that my department is going to try to take on is whenever we're doing vegetation work or tree work, it's somehow notifying the public. Similar to the process that the zoning, planning and zoning, when they put out the signs, when an area is getting ready to be rezoned, something similar to that, because we have some citizens that may go in the park once a month or twice a month, and they're not aware of any work that's going to be done. So we think that process will probably help, and if we put that out 2 or 3 months before any work gets done, then we can be able to engage with the community and get some feedback with that. So at this time, if there's any other questions.
I just have a comment. I don't know what the plans will be going forward, but one way that really could be used to rectify the problem is that you can't replace a mature fruit tree. But trees that grow up from established roots grow much faster, and allowing the Fruit and Nut Club or Bountiful Cities to graft onto the sprouts that come up from those existing stumps would grow new apple trees much more quickly than planting new saplings.
Yes, and when we spoke to that on the on-site meeting, Bountiful Cities was ready to wait for us to finish the impact on the trees and then look at how we can mitigate that. So that was part of our conversation.
Thank you.
Any other questions? So, you want to add something to this, Gary? Here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me that opportunity. I just want to bring a little bit more focus on the three points that are up there. And we didn't talk about this, or I didn't see this before, but I think if you follow these three points, what you would have expected to happen is that the neighborhood, Bountiful Cities, maybe the Food Council, important stakeholders would have been aware of the program. My understanding is that to some degree, number one has taken place. Number two, in terms of good use of tools, in addition to notifying the neighborhood that work would take place, notifying the food interest groups that was going to take place, but two, did they lay out the plan in a way that everybody knew exactly what was going to happen? And was that in the form that could be distributed to the stakeholders and the members of those groups, not just the people who might attend the neighborhood meeting, not just the person who sat down with the assistant director of the department? And finally, in terms of level of participation, I'm not sure that a satisfactory level of expectation was communicated of what in sharing this information and planning to bring the plan back to Dawa's original graph. What were the roles and what were we looking to get in terms of feedback? What consultation is supposed to take place? So I think there are lessons to be learned across the board, and as Roger said as well, the internal communication was not as coordinated as we would expect it to be. The plan was shared with members of the park management team the same day that the work was commissioned. Did not give assistant director of the department an opportunity to take that plan to Bountiful Cities and let them see the work was already commissioned. So that's a core piece of coordination internally, that the plan that Roger started with, which is like we're going to create a checklist and people are going to have to follow it and sign-offs will occur, would prevent that kind of activity from occurring. So I just wanted to give a very practical overview of how the steps are pretty well known, but we had some performance issues in the way it was carried out and had higher expectations for it.
I just want to say a quick thing. This is, so none of this is difficult. None of these individual steps is difficult. I think I would encourage us, the city, not to get too sort of hidebound in process of this and documenting and communications plans for everything. It's not difficult. There just needs to be a core commitment to making sure that the right people are at the table when the decisions get made. And I think that's actually just, I mean, that should be, I hope that is every public servant's instinct. I have confidence that what you're doing is going to get us there. And I would just ask the folks who are here today and watching to just continue to try to hold us accountable for this. Again, it's not difficult. We just need to have that commitment and we need to do it.
Okay, so our normal procedure for a presentation for this portion of the agenda is that it's not an action item for us and we don't take public comment on the item. But I do have three people that signed up who wanted to talk about this topic. And if I make you wait until the very end of this meeting, it could take a while. So I thought it would be better just to go ahead and have your input now. So I've got three people who have signed up. And if you don't want to speak now, you can tell me that. But you would have an opportunity to speak now, and you have up to 3 minutes. And is the timer still working? Okay. The first person I have is Kiara Boulan. I hope I'm saying that right. I'm not sure if that. Yes? Oh, I semi-butchered it. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Just
pull
up.
Yeah. Thank you. My name is Kira Boulan, and I appreciate the opportunity to meet you. I don't think it was a butchering, really. Yeah. You're pretty close, actually. I am the new coordinator for the Asheville-Buncombe County Food Policy Council, and appreciate the opportunity to briefly address you today. First of all, I do want to thank the council for the existing partnerships that go into edibles in our city. Food Action Plan, which is really important to us and already doing good work. We're looking forward to continuing to revise that in community for the Sustainability Office and for the support for the Food Policy Council work. I do want to acknowledge publicly the vast edible resources that are here in Asheville. My family and I are relatively new to the city, and that is a reputation that preceded our moving here. We're really something that you should be really proud of, and I appreciate the good work that's going on at the community and the government level, both in terms of food access and food security, and also in light of the recent event at George Washington Carver Park and an educational opportunity. These edible plantings that we have in the city, both the ones that exist now, which are many, and those that are planned through Edible Mile and other projects, are an incredible opportunity for us as a public-private nonprofit partnership to educate people on what the plants are that exist in their neighborhood already, how to plant more plants, take care of their own, their family needs, and their community needs, and also how to prepare and use those needs to address actual food insecurity challenges that we have here in the city that are very real. So the George Washington Carver Park incident is first and foremost a communications incident, but also allows us to shed light on some important work that we can do together in the nonprofit community with City Council to elevate the role of edibles in our city and to think about them really to address food security, sustainability issues, and also to think about an educational opportunity to help our city residents eat more food, supply more food to themselves, their families, and our neighbors. I did provide a letter to some of the members of council in advance of the meeting tonight that I just want to recap extremely briefly. One is thinking about communication between public departments and nonprofit partners like the Food Policy Council. We did a collected some input from stakeholders, the Tree Commission, representatives from Bountiful Cities, Urban Agriculture Alliance, the Community Gardens Network, the Buncombe County Food and Nut Club, thinking about what went wrong in this particular instance and what could we put forward as ways that we can proactively work together to improve communications. In the spectrum, I really like to see us move towards the collaborate and empower end of the communication spectrum, and that was obviously something that was missing in this particular incident. We'd love to move from notifications to engaging with people here, specifically to think about strategies to work with lower income communities, low wealth communities. I know that my time is short, so please understand existing edible plantings here in town and provide support for the educational initiatives that can come from these plantings. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. And then I have Darcel Evans.
Hi. What do you need from me? You need my name and what else? I've never done this
before. Okay.
That's not my 3 minutes, by the way. So you start when I start.
So just state your name. Tell us what organization you're with, and you have 3 minutes, as indicated by the buzzer.
All right, so my name is Darcel Evans. I'm Executive Director of Bountiful Cities. And I want to say that Bountiful Cities, actually, we've been managing the edible park since 2002. And it has, and I think that there has been more awareness on the value of the edible park. It's the First Nation edible park in the United States. Other people have come here. We've spent a lot of time with other communities and our resources and getting them up and going. So I do want to say, and I also want to say that the city was quick to apologize over this, and I do want to acknowledge that apology. But I also want to say that that this has created a lot of conflict and a lot of tension within the city and within the community, and especially because this is just a few months behind the whole Montford Park. And I think a lot of what has happened is that a lot of people have put a lot of their volunteer hours into this, and they feel dismissed by the city. They feel because there was a lot of communication that went out about that two-year back and forth, and there was only Bountiful Cities was only mentioned one time. So in that, in the roots of conflict, you know, we understand we have limited resources, unmet needs, and different values. And then also, I want to talk about values on this. Yes, our limited resources that we're all scrambling to do the best with what we have. Our unmet needs seem to be, in this particular instance, is safety. And then the different values is was the community input. And, you know, the conflict is somebody did something wrong and we're trying to fix it. And we're all on board with the long term, you know, like what, how do we move here for long term? And we're an organization that is known for our collaboration for many, many years. We might be blunt, we might be truthful, but we collaborate. And so when I say that solving the conflict and somebody did something that was wrong, and when I go back to values, I just want to say that that accountability, like somebody issued that work order and that continues to come up. And I know Roderick has taken accountability, but you know, we've been working with the city for a long time, y'all, and I just have to say, when we want something from the city, it's a process for a work order. And, you know, let's go to accountability. And I think that it's important to recognize, hey, we're sorry, we take part of this. But also, it's important to recognize there was tension there. And there continues to be tension. And people feel that they've been asked, you're asking for forgiveness. And I'm glad to see this communication plan. I'm in. I'll be happy to work with you on that.
Okay, thank you. And Nicole Hinneman.
Hello, thank you. My name is Nicole Heinbaugh, and I'm with Bountiful Cities, also the Urban Agriculture Alliance and the Food Policy Council. I also wanted to just bring to you, we did actually print out some of the letters that Kira referenced earlier so that you all can look at them and read them. There are a number of recommendations in here that might be useful as you consider how to move forward with this issue. Is it okay to approach? I think that much of what is important to be said has been touched on already, but I would like to acknowledge and applaud that the Office of Sustainability of the City of Asheville has been working very hard to collaborate and to engage with the community and to represent the values that are shared between the city and many of the community organizations and the public, and particularly along the lines of food access and edibles, and the different points that are in the food action plan that the city has passed. And I want to say that one of the things that stood out the most in this situation that took place is that because that work has been moved forward so incredibly, since the director of the Office of Sustainability, Amber Weaver's presence, it was particularly difficult to realize that she was not consulted in this process and that she would be the person who would have the most connections with who should be at the table, who should be consulted, which community partners might need to be engaged. And yet, even internally, that department was not even acknowledged or consulted during the process. And so while I hear and recognize what you're saying with the communications plan, that you're going to look at improving things both internally and externally, interdepartmentally, I just want to say that this all could have been easily prevented with a simple email or walking across the hall or picking up a phone. And so just to remember that in the future, that there are incredible assets at work within your own city staff, and to really utilize those, call on those in every instance that it you know, makes sense, most relevant instances.
Thank you.
And I have one final person to sign up to speak under this item, and that's Vicki Mead.
Good
Hi.
Mrs. Creighton.
I'm Vicki Meath. I'm the Director of Just Economics, and I just wanted to speak to this issue to say that what happened here kind of it is extends beyond this issue with the edible park. It extends to like the how our city communicates with community groups in general. And I think I would ask you to take a serious look at this and flag this as a concern. And I'd be happy to talk with you at greater length, but I think we need to take a look at who gets listened to, who gets invited to the table, who gets responded to. As I think you all know, I've been my organization has been leading a transit campaign, and I've had many experiences in communicating with staff. The vast majority of the time, it's been us constantly pressing and constantly following up and not really ever coming to us. We know we're there. And so, like, how are people listened to? Who gets listened to? And I'm just kind of letting you know that marginalized people, people of color, poor people in this community don't feel like they are listened to. And this is a broader problem. And it's great to see some diversity on our committees. But beyond that, I mean, a lot of times our folks don't feel like the city listens to them. So I think this is a large issue. I'd like you to flag, and I'd love to talk to you more than 3 minutes worth on this issue. I don't have any prepared remarks. I just want to flag this as a great concern for how we build a diverse and a community rich with good community input. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that concludes this item, which was just scheduled for a presentation. This obviously is a major issue for a certain segment of our community when this event happened. And again, the council wanted to make sure we were able to show the community that internally the issue has been or is being addressed and have an opportunity for a public discussion of it. So thank you for participating in that. Thank you for the folks that came here and spoke tonight.
And now, you wrap that up so nicely. Sorry to just kind of crack it right open here again. I really appreciate everyone who just came up to speak because, well, for a lot of different reasons. But as we've been trying to figure out all of this stuff, one of the things that led me to was to look back at George Washington Carver himself. The park has held that name for so long, and you can kind of just get used to a name and kind of forget what's behind it. But Carver was born a slave, and he went on to become a free man and become a renowned botanist who moved forward agriculture across the nation, across the world. And one of the things that he said really strikes home for me, and it's not the style of clothes one wears, neither the kind of automobile one drives, nor the amount of money one has in the bank that counts. These mean nothing. It is simply service that measures success. And the folks who came up here to speak tonight all are certainly service-oriented, service-minded, service-motivated people, and so I just want to acknowledge that, as well as all the Fruit Nut Club people and all the Bountiful Cities volunteers and everyone involved with the Food Policy Council and Nicole and her work in housing. This is a really unfortunate way to get to a bunch of improvements. But it really does feel like we've stumbled across a springboard of some sort. The Food Action Plan was initially passed years ago, and then it was recommitted to just this past January by this council. And I think that what we're seeing and what this is indicative of is the attempt to really institutionalize these values into the city organization. And what I anticipate from this is that this is going to more deeply embed this into the city organization. So we're going to have not only fewer of these problems, but it's my hope we're going to see more and more opportunities going forward with our contractual partners, like with Bountiful Cities, just to make sure that we're as good a partnership that we can be, but also to really grow those partnerships and make sure that all the people are at the table, who we've invited to the table, where we've said, hey, please come. And then if the door doesn't really feel open, then it feels like an empty request. And that's certainly something that we don't want to be doing. We're gonna keep moving forward. We're going to have more food in our rights of way, along our greenways, in our parks. This is all part of the Food Action Plan. This is coming. And as it's coming, we have to have the processes in place to make sure not only that we're doing a good job, but that we're really maximizing the resources of our community. There's a lot of people who want to come help, and we really want you to come help. And so we've got to really make sure we do a good job of that. As far as George Washington Carver right now, being able just to replace those trees, sounds like Cecil knows more about it than I do. I'm no expert when it comes to food, but I rely on the expertise of everybody else. But also recognize that we can go ahead and start taking some other steps to identify those needs at that park as well as the future plantings, and to be able to move forward with the resources that we're gonna need to make all that really, really successful. Whether that's simply planting and the educational pieces, or if we can take bigger, broader steps, not only to achieve the Food Action Plan, but also to rebuild trust and to expand trust in this policy field that we're exploring and trying to get better at. So thanks for giving me a minute to lay all that stuff out, but I'm very hopeful that this is going to accelerate our implementation of the Food Action Plan, and we will be able to look back at it and say this was the moment when it all started working.
Okay, does anyone else have a comment to add to this item before we go to the public hearings agenda? No. Okay, thank you for that word. All right, we have two items on our public hearings agenda. The first item is a public hearing to consider a land use incentive grant for Simpson Street. And Jeff, I have that Jeff Stone here presenting this, and here he comes. Fighting his way to the front. Do we need to rotate the iPhone so that it looks at the person who's talking, or are we just, it's all right, we can leave it the way it is.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council, Jeff Stoudemire, Assistant Director for Community and Economic Development. And I'm here presenting an application for a land use incentive grant. It's been applied for by Bowcatcher Common LLC. Kirk Booth is here representing Bowcatcher Common. The proposed development is a 70-unit affordable housing development located on Simpson Street, which is indicated on the map that's on your overhead display. As you know, the land use incentive grant has basic qualifications. Those qualifications include that the development consists of three or more dwelling units for rent, at least 10% of the units would be affordable, that the units would be affordable at least to income eligible households for a minimum period of 15 years. The proposed development must be in the city limits, and it must be located to provide residents convenient access to jobs, schools, and services. The staff has determined that the project meets the eligibility requirements, and we would move forward to the application with the decision at your discretion, but the project is awarded points based upon how it relates to the application criteria. The project in question as scored by staff and as agreed to by the developer would appear to qualify for 110 points. Scored in this way, the proposed project will provide 70 units affordable to households at 60% or less of median income. I will note that the qualification is 80%. While there are no additional points for qualification of 60% of median income, that is a commitment the developer has made. And it will be affordable for at least the minimum period of 15 years. This would, according to the land use incentive policy, qualify the project for 100 points. Additionally, the developer has also agreed that they would lease to eligible households and maintain that affordable rent for a period of 20 years, 5 years in addition to the policy of 15 years, which would qualify the project for an additional 10 points. According to the land use incentive grant policy, this would make the developer eligible for two benefits. One would be
that they would be eligible for 11 years of the land use incentive grant. That grant being an amount equal to the difference between the tax value, the city of Asheville property tax, the difference between the tax on the value of the property today and the tax at the value of the property once developed. Would also qualify the developer for 10% of a fee rebate for each 10 points. So in this case, the developer would be eligible for a fee rebate of 100% of the City of Asheville permit fees, building permit fees for the project. Fiscal impact of this project would be that the estimated subsidy would be per unit of $3,553 per unit. And over the span of this incentive, it would be eligible for an incentive $248,710. Additionally, it would be eligible for a fee rebate of an estimated amount of $125,000. The total estimated land use incentive grant then would be $373,710. I will note that that amount will be determined by the actual post-completion assessed value and the actual cost of the permit. So this is an estimate at this period of time. If we put those together, the total estimated land use incentive grant per unit would be $5,339. I will also note that the project has also been approved for a housing trust fund grant of $300,000. Which at that time was for 60 units. The total amount per unit of total subsidy provided for this project would be less than $10,000 per unit, as currently determined. So knowing that our normal incentives approach $15,000 to $20,000 per unit, it's a very cost-effective project relative to our policy and the subsidies we provide. That concludes my presentation, and be very happy to answer questions after the public hearing, should you have them, or now, should you have questions.
Does anyone have any questions before we begin the public hearing? Okay, and do we want to hear from the applicant first, or if we don't, it's optional. Okay, all right, now we will open the public hearing. If there's anyone wishing to comment on this item, you have 3 minutes to do so. If you'll just state your name.
Hi, my name is Amy Kemp, and I'm a resident of Asheville, and I'm just curious as to how the calculation was made. Like, where is the schedule that shows exactly what was taken into consideration and the weight given to it? I'd like to see that.
Anybody else?
That's all. Thanks.
Jeff, did you hear the question? The question was, how is the calculation? Do we have the formula? How the scoring is determined? If there's
the land use policy, land use incentive grant policy provides a matrix of scoring. I'm sorry, I don't have a copy of that scoring policy here with me, but it does lay out very specifically what scores are available, what points are available, based upon the developer's commitment. I will note, although this wasn't asked, that it is a performance-based program, that once, if approved, the property becomes deed restricted, so it follows the deed, and it is monitored both for rental affordability and household eligibility on an annual basis by the staff of the Community Development Division.
And the scoring information is available on our website, I assume. Yes.
It is, correct.
Is there anyone else wishing to comment on this item?
Amy, As far as how to access that stuff, I just Googled it up, Asheville, L-U-I-G, and it pulled it right up at the city site, Asheville, L-U-I-G, Grant Matrix.
For this project?
Well, just the general matrix that's used for all projects that would come to us who were applying for this grant.
No, I'm asking about this project. That's what I was asking.
Of the elements in the matrix, these were the two items. One was around the affordability, and one was around the length of term of the affordability that qualified for the 11, for the rather 110 points.
That anyone else wanted to comment on this, but is there anyone else wishing to comment on this item? Okay, I'm going to close the public hearing. Any other questions, comments from council or motion?
Yeah, my comment would be that looking at how often we seem to have to coerce, cajole, struggle to get developers to provide a few units that are affordable, this is a really great project. 70 units, affordable to households of 60% or less of median income. I mean, this is making a real dent in the need for affordable housing here. And so I'm really impressed with the project.
Was that a motion?
I move to approve the LGE grant.
Second. Okay, I have a motion and a second. Anyone else want to comment or have a question? All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Right, and next, there's only one other item on our public hearings agenda, and that is a public hearing to consider an amendment to Chapter 7 of the UDO to remove the signage plan application process, and Shannon Tuck is officially waiting.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. Thank you, Mayor, members of council. I'll keep this very brief. Essentially, this is a wording amendment that seeks to bring a small portion of our city code into alignment with some recent state and federal court decisions. Those decisions have brought some clarity to how municipalities should regulate signage. The signage plan, as it currently exists in the ordinance, provides a legislative review option for requests that don't meet the minimum technical standards for signage. We now understand in better detail that this isn't an appropriate application path for somebody seeking relief from our development standards for signs, and that a more appropriate path would be to have a discretionary review at the Board of Adjustment. That option also exists in the ordinance right now, so by removing the signage plan, it just properly funnels all future requests to the Board of Adjustment. And that is sort of a quick summary. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have, or if you'd like to open for public comment.
Yeah, I'm curious. So this would mean that all variances on signed packages would only go to the Board of Adjustment?
Correct. The board is the body that's authorized to review variances. They wouldn't necessarily be a package. It would be more just individual signed requests.
Well, what I mean, I guess to be specific, for instance, a couple of weeks ago, a month ago, we talked about the Ingalls package, which exceeded many elements of our sign ordinance. That would go to the Board of Adjustment and not to the City Council. Is there no way to, the language that I read said, what you just said was to bring this into alignment with federal and state. Is there no way to retain council control and bring it into alignment? In other words, change the language in some way that it would make the council decision in alignment with the rules? Or does the federal government say a Board of Adjustment must do this?
You want me to answer that?
Good.
Okay.
Thanks. The federal decision has to do with just the overall sign ordinance of probably every municipality in the United States. The state case, which is consistent with the statutes, is that different bodies of government can do different things. If the council enacts the ordinance ordinances. They do legislative acts. So that you pass the ordinance and, so, and it says what signs you can have. If you want to vary from the legislative law, the procedure under the general statutes is to go to the Board of Adjustment and ask for a variance. You have to have sworn witnesses, you have to put on evidence, you have to prove a hardship, and that standard's in the statute. So you have to somehow establish why you can't comply when everybody else has to. Now, if you wanted to bring it back legislatively, it would be you would have to pass a new ordinance with new sign standards instead of doing it on a case-by-case basis. So anytime that somebody wants to get out of a requirement, they have to go through this process according to the state. We had this come up in a case not too long ago, which basically says anytime that there is discretion in a decision, it has to have a quasi-judicial hearing, and it has to have standards. So that's the way to do it. If you wanted to, I suppose, pass a sign ordinance for every single body who wanted the sign, you could do that, but that's not really practical either. Now, you can still have a sign package with that comply. If you wanted to have a process where, you know, you have somebody who needs 100 signs coming and do it at one time, but they all otherwise comply with the sign ordinance, that's fine. The other thing you could do is you could appoint yourself to be the Board of Adjustment for signs, which you probably don't want to do either. So, that was probably too much information, but.
Thank you very much for the explanation.
Okay, and so a point of clarification just for me, I mean, right now the Board of Adjustment sees sign variance applications already. They're doing that, and they do that for one-off signs I used to serve on the Board of Adjustment. We did lots of them, and generally speaking, they were, the only time they really would consider it is if for some reason someone was replacing an already existing sign. But anyway, that's anecdote. Right now, we see these sign packages like Ingalls, the Airport, Mission Hospital, UNC Asheville. Those are the ones that I recall come to council. So those would all now go to the Board of Adjustment under this. That's what the proposal
is. That's correct.
Okay, and then they would fall under the regular rules for the Board of Adjustment, which is basically you have to establish this hardship.
Which or is, they can comply with the ordinance.
Right, then they don't need to go to the Board of Adjustment. Right. They just comply with the ordinance.
Right.
But it would be this quasi-judicial process, and they would have to meet the criteria and it's very specific criarteria. Okay, I'm clear on it. Does anyone else have a question about this before I open the public hearing? No? Okay, I'm going to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to comment on this item? I'm going to close the public hearing. Do I have any other questions or a motion? I move to approve the wording amendment removing the application and review process for signage plans. Is in the public interest and is consistent with the comprehensive plan and other adopted plans in the following ways. One, the amendment will result in sign variance applications being directed to the Asheville Board of Adjustment, where such reviews are standard and will be determined pursuant to the quasi-judicial process.
How about a second?
Second.
All right, I have a motion and a second. All right, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Aye. We have one opposed that I noted. All right, that concludes the public hearings on our agenda. We do not have any unfinished business on our agenda, and we have one item of new business. That is a downtown public space management, street performance, high impact areas, considering an ordinance amending chapter 16 of the Code of Ordinance. For the selling, entertaining, and dining ordinance related to street performances and adding a new appendix H to create two high impact areas in the downtown for street performers. And Paul Featherson is here to talk to us about this item.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. This evening I'm here to present to you the latest recommendations that came through the Public Safety Committee. Regarding the Downtown Public Space Management Initiative. So just to recap for you, the Downtown Public Space Management Initiative is really about every aspect of the public space, not just buskers and street performances. This is one component of that initiative. So as you know, this has been an item that the Public Safety Committee has been dealing with for some time. started at least, if not earlier than 2014, back in 2014 with the downtown enhancement plan for the police department. Since then, it's progressed. We made a presentation to the PSC probably back in August of 2015, where the PSC asked us to engage with the stakeholders a little bit more. We put together a stakeholders group that contained businesses, residents, the Asheville Busking, Coalition, Collective, I'm sorry, and the Asheville Downtown Association. We've met with them over the last year or so, and we came up with some proposals, which we presented to the Public Safety Committee. So Public Safety Committee took action in September, and so that's what we're going to present you with today. So basically, we're talking about high-impact areas. We've identified two areas that we believe have some high impact from a traffic, from a safety perspective, and in a way to, maximize the experience of the downtown visit by both local people and those outside our area. Those two areas are the Flatiron Sculpture at Battery Park and Wall Street, and Haywood Street in front of the Woolworth Block. And there are a few components at a high level before we get into each location. There would be only one audible performance allowed in the areas, which would be designated by an artistic symbol. There would be no designated space. They would just have to be, there would be a center point of that 120 feet distance, which we've identified, in which no other audible performances can occur. The ordinance amendments that we are proposing are only for the high impact areas. We are not impacting any other areas within the city. So the markings that we are proposing, the center point, as you see, would be the multicolored rendition. This is from a local artist, Ian Wilkinson. And the blue one would be the 120-foot boundary. There would also be a marking of the 6-foot. The ordinances currently require a 6-foot pedestrian passageway from the curb to the performance area. That would be marked as well in this area, in the two areas. So again, the two areas we are talking about are Woolworth Walk, the Flatiron Sculpture, 120-foot distance. There would be no impact on any other popular spots from the Woolworth Walk location. However, on the Flatiron Sculpture location, other audible performances on the opposite Wall Street corner would be impacted. So here's a Woolworth Walk, and it's just to show you, and kudos to Dana Frankel. She helped to get that pole that was in the middle of the sidewalk removed. That pole is no longer there. But as you can see, it is a fairly small space. And when you have performances there, as you can see on the right, there's not enough room for people to pass by, and people are not comfortable passing through in front of the performance. They go out into the street. So this is intended to help that. And this is just to show you, the committee went through a number of options, and this shows you the option distance-wise that we looked at, and 120 is marked right there. And so it's not impacting, at least for the Woolworth Walk, it's not impacting any other performance areas. So then the other location is the Flatiron Sculpture on Wall Street. And again, you can see what the Flatiron Sculpture looks like without any performances there. And then you can see what it looks like when there is a performance there that sometimes causes people to go in the street. So again, we are trying to minimize the risk, the public safety risk, and to maximize the downtown experience. And again, this is a map of what we looked at. And the one impact on this one would be the opposite corner of Wall Street, where other audible performances would not be permitted. So, to summarize the ordinance revisions that are before you, there's an addition of a definition of audible performance in high impact areas. There's language regarding the value of street performances and a number of other important interests. And it also identifies the high impact area locations, distance requirements, only one audible performance within the area, and a requirement for a 40-foot distance of non-audible performances from the audible performance within the high impact area, if that makes sense. So, next steps. Depending on the council action this evening, if you choose to take action, center points in the traffic areas and the 120-foot boundaries will be marked in addition to the minimum pedestrian passageway. Educational materials will be developed, distributed, and available through the city website. Staff will provide quarterly check-ins and updates to the Public Safety Committee based on metrics and feedback. We'll have ongoing conversations with the businesses, residents, and the ABC and the ADA. We will develop this. Performance metrics will be difficult on this one, and measuring them will be difficult, but we will develop performance metrics and monitor them and use those as reporting to the PSC and council. And again, depending on the action you take this evening, if you choose to take action, we will be ready to implement within 2 weeks. There was a high desire of the public safety community to try to get something in place to try it in part of the remaining hot season and go from there. So that is what you have before you this evening. There was other initiatives within the public downtown public space management, which we highlighted, which we're happy to address if you have any questions. And there's staff here, and the ABC is here as well, and other stakeholders.
Does anyone have any questions of Paul? Thanks, Paul. You brought together very succinctly a very big, messy conversation. One question I had is we did not talk at public safety about a distance between audible and non-audible performers within that 120. So you all have settled on 40 feet. And I'm curious how you got there and with a sort of a particular eye to how that impacts the Flatiron sculpture and the one site that's just the opposite of it.
Sure, great point, and I apologize for not having that for you. You are correct. So the 40 feet, I believe, and I can, John Maddox is here from the city attorney's office who can address the drafting, but I believe he probably relied upon the fact that the 40 feet is existing right now for other performances.
That's correct.
But you are also correct on the Wall Street. It's a great catch that the 40 feet,
John, would the 40 feet knock out?
I would assume the 40 feet would knock out that location for that model.
That's correct. It's the same. It is the same. Essentially, that's just clarifying that the same restrictions that apply everywhere in the city and have applied for years would continue to apply there as it relates to non-audible performers and audible performers. That, so 40 feet is, it would probably knock out that location for non-audible performers.
So currently, you couldn't have an audible performer and a non-audible performer on those opposite corners, is that at the same time?
Assuming compliance with the law, that's correct.
Okay. And I understand you said a non-audible and an audible? What about Wall Street? You could have a non-audible on one corner and audible on the other?
Not with the 40 feet.
Not the 40 feet, oh, I see, I'm sorry. Gotcha, okay. And for those people who may not be clear about that, who don't think about this a lot, and we have thought about it a lot in public safety for a long time, and talked to a lot of people, and had a lot of great input over these years. The statues, like the drummer girl or a tarot card reader, don't generally attract a crowd that stays in place for as long as an audible performance. The audible performances will get people who are there for a few songs, for instance, whereas the drummer girl may just be there for a few minutes, you know, that anyway. So they haven't generated the crowds that the music performances have.
Okay, so I'm trying to remember where we are in this process. So we heard our presentation, we had a question. Does anyone else have a question of Paul? No, okay. So I think we are going to need to have a motion if we want to consider adopting this, but we probably, you look like you might want to say something. Robin, did you need to say anything? No, okay. I know we have some people that are interested in this topic, and so why don't we pretend this is a public hearing and open this up for comment now. And again, say rules apply, please state your name, and you have 3 minutes.
So I'm doing
Hi, I'm Andrew Fletcher, and I'm switching hacks now from the Asheville Bus Streets Collective. I just want to say thank you to the Public Safety Committee for allowing this to come through now instead of earlier, because this is a good plan, and we're supportive of it. I think this is going to help address some of the public safety issues that we see from basically that are signs of success, signs of the vitality of our city that we have. That we are dealing with this in this way. You know, most other cities deal with busking and the lack of busking and why and how that they have to encourage it. So we're sort of in a unique place here in Asheville with that, especially for a smaller city. And there's not a lot of good models when you look at other cities and you say, well, how are those other cities doing it? A lot of those other cities, you look at the outcome of, and really, if they had a busking culture, they no longer do. So, I thank staff for really trying to sort of invent a new wheel on this, because that was what was required if you want to maintain the really amazing busking culture that we have here that not only benefits me as a performer who enjoys playing on the street, but affects the entire music economy. It has an impact up into the layers of gigging and other musicianship later. So it's a very important piece that we try to maintain this. So I'd like to thank the members of the Public Safety Committee, also the ones from 2 years ago when we started. Jane Davis and Chris Cousin, wherever you are now. Thank them for having the patience and allowing the Buskers Collective to be a big part of this process. And I really feel like there wasn't a lot of precedent for me and my advocacy for this. And when I looked around, I said, okay, where are the other Andrew Fletchers and other cities doing this kind of work? And I really didn't find it. So thanks for, we all kind of came together and are trying this out in our own way. And I hope that other cities look to us as leaders on this from our success with that. So I really want to say thank you to the staff who put countless hours into this and to everybody else. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? Okay. All right. We will need a motion. Yes. All right. Go ahead. You want to move? No, you don't want to move.
Well, I just want to say, no, seriously,
that. Well, I was going to do the things too, but it's, he seemed ready to move. So.
I would like to move.
Yeah.
We want to see him move.
So considering the approval of the actual Buskers Collective and the comments from Mr. Fletcher, I would like to make a motion that we move forward with the new business of the downtown public space management and performances and high impact of the access. So whatever that motion is, that's what I'm making.
Okay, Julie made the second. All right, so we have a motion and a second. I just wanted to add my quick thanks for all the hard work. I know this has taken a long time and all the members of the community that participated in this to get us to a good result that it looks like we have a pretty good consensus about. So thank you for all your time and dedication to the issue.
For folks who haven't been tuned into this for the last 2 years, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I think if we haven't kind of backed up and said, well, why is this happening at all? And there were concerns about the safety of pedestrians moving through downtown and the use of public space. And it's my understanding that through this process, we've identified that it turns out that busking is not the cause of a lot of those public safety issues where people are going out on the street. Some of that is the pedestrians themselves, some of it is light poles that are in places that there need not be light poles or other impediments to people moving through. And it's been through this partnership with the artists downtown that we've been able to better identify how to make the whole civic space be more productive and flow better, as well as being safer for everybody. So it's this marriage of design and art and culture and safety and commerce, and to have it come out like this tonight is really gratifying, and to have leaders come forward from the arts and culture community and help us get it right is just great. Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, I have a motion and a second. Is there anyone who would like to comment on the motion? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye. Any opposed? Okay. That concludes the formal agenda. We do now have an opportunity for anyone who would like to provide comment now. Again, the same rules apply. Please state your name, and you have 3 minutes. All the people I had signed up to provide comment already did so during presentations, but if there's anyone else, please raise your hand. Yes.
My name is Dawn Nelson. I don't have anything prepared. It's an observation. I live in the East End neighborhood, so was very affected by the whole. And I'm a big fan of the fruit nuts, not a big fan of staff. In anything I've come to City Council to see happen, development or this issue or anything, there seems to be this, you know, wonderful service-oriented aspect of the council itself that wants Asheville to be the unique and wonderful thing Asheville can be. And then there are these wonderful citizens who are doing all kinds of crazy and wonderful things. And then there's staff. And that seems to be a very dark and impenetrable place to get to. And things seem to disappear in a welter of process and PowerPoint and best practices. And I would just love to see what I think Gordon mentioned and Julie mentioned too, a little more attention to actual personal access instead of a process. Because I think you're all good intentions, I think people are, and we could make this such a great city. You know, it's the city we all dream about. And I just am sorry when I see what I don't feel like I have access. And I mean, I can't. But, you know, how do we actually really have a conversation? I'm just seeing it all fall into, I tried. I went to some of these process committees and organizations, and no one has time for all that. We need to be able to just deal as humans with each other. And I did, there was one member of staff who came to our last East End neighborhood meeting. I've forgotten her name, but she came to see what was happening at Hunt Hill that had been a big issue for the neighborhood. But staff said, well, we have a process and we have a plan and everything's wonderful. She came and saw it, and I was really impressed. She apologized. She said, I was horrified. I have no idea. We didn't come out and see. We looked at our plan and we thought everything was in place, and it wasn't. And that was really, really a lovely thing. And whoever she is, Keith, I'm sure you know who that was. Give her kudos. She was, and it was really a good thing, and I would love to see a lot more of that. Thanks.
Okay, is there anyone else?
Yeah, two things I'd like to mention. One really sad. Many of you remember Fred English. He was a longtime gadfly here at City Council. He always had an opinion. I got to know him pretty well. He was a pretty good friend. He was the sweetest old curmudgeon I had probably ever met. He died this week of complications after heart surgery. And he'll be missed in the community. He was one of the loud voices to help get the Veterans Memorial put out here in front of the courthouse. So that's just the sad passing, somebody who won't be back to council. The other thing that will come back to council, and I think it's already been brought to at least one of the committees, is the idea of doing a tree canopy study of Asheville. Many cities have done evaluations of what their tree canopy is, because tree canopies are disappearing in cities across the country. Ours is falling fast here. And I believe it's the University of Virginia, but I could be wrong. It is a university in Virginia that does this sort of thing. And they're willing to split costs with the city of Asheville to do a thoroughgoing study of our tree canopy. And our portion would be $5,000. The tree commission wants to bring that forward here. And I just thought I'd let you know that it's coming. It's a way to gauge where we are and where we want to be and what we want to see planted going into the future.
Just reminding people to, before our next meeting, will be our next meeting is election day, so vote. And vote early if you can. And the open enrollment for insurance starts November 1st. So just be aware of that and get educated.
Cecil, to your point about the canopy study, it's already been before planning and economic development. The three of us heard it there, and staff is working on different ways that could look, and they're going to bring it back to us at our next meeting, so probably early next year by the time it gets here. Also, just wanted to congratulate everybody who was involved with making the case to keep the Southern Conference basketball tournament at the city of Asheville. The leadership there decided the best way to make sure that their players were respected and honored and protected, as well as the best way to protest against HB2 was to have their basketball tournament in the city of Asheville. And it took a full court press of legislators and other electeds to make that happen. So that'll be back in March. Get your tickets early. The other thing, just wanted to let you all know, I just came back from the North Carolina League of Municipalities, which is a whole lot of folks from a whole lot of towns all over North Carolina. And on Sunday, they worked on their legislative advocacy goals. And a lot of this was more geared towards some of the smaller municipalities across the state. But I will say that there were some really common themes that emerged. One was around local governments being able to exercise local control. And it didn't matter whether it was a red town or a blue town, that was a theme that was common across those cities. And that local control ought to extend to utilities, to how you conduct your elections and when you conduct your elections, as well as having more control over one's own revenue and revenue sources. So you'll be seeing those advocacy goals come out at the conference, but it was an honor to represent the city there. And we have a lot of allies across the state.
Okay, so with that, our meeting is adjourned.